Everybody, my pleasure to welcome you to this weekend and to welcome our guest ward here to discuss interesting things about God Speaks. And he has such a phenomenal knowledge and understanding and unique research to draw on, so we're very fortunate to have him here. So he came to Barbara in 1970, but most of you probably come across the world before. If there's anything else that he feels you need to know about him, I'll let him tell you, I think. That's probably safest. But he's also a prolific musician, a songwriter, a scholar, and a very interesting doxer. So, without much ado, Jay Barrow, welcome.
So what's your favourite colour?
I don't even have one. So thank you all for coming, this is the first of a two-weekend program of 8 sessions like this, devoted to God Speaks. Most of you, how many have read God Speaks? Yeah. Many of you I know are very well acquainted with it. Some of you might feel that you know it somewhat, and some might feel bemused and baffled. Whatever you're coming from, wherever you're coming from, whatever you bring to this, you're welcome here. And I hope everyone will feel very welcome to bring up questions and bring up points as we proceed. Like just, a lecture format. It's like sitting and listening to someone talk nonstop for hours together. It can be rather deadening. So I do hope that you'll, ask questions or bring up points as we go on through. I do know there are a lot of people here who are indeed very well versed in these subjects and would have interesting perspectives to bring to it. Having myself studied God Speaks for a long time. I guess I first read it in 1971, and I must have read, 30, 40 times by now. I'm more and more dazzled by it. There are very few books that are capable of that. I find most books, even great books by great authors, at a certain point, would have become thin for me. I'll be dazzled by the genius of the writer, let's say, but I come to feel, I know it's here now. Basically, it's found kind of the depth of what this author has to give me. But there are just a few works that seem to arise from an infinite depth. I find that the Bhagavad Gita would be an example of that, and other works of scriptural greatness, I suppose you could say. And God Speaks is definitely in that category. In fact, a couple of years ago, we had been doing one-day readings of God Speaks. I've done maybe 3 or 4 in 1 year. And I had read it so many times. And we started a one-day reading. And before we started, I thought, I think I know God Speaks well enough at this point where on a surface level, I'm not talking about the depth, but on a surface level, there's not going to be anything I haven't noticed before, just a surface feature of it. And the first paragraph proved me wrong. It's like I find that Baba keeps rewriting the book every time I sit down to read it, and more comes into view. It is indeed a book like that. I also feel that of all the reading I've done in my life, I've never read anything quite like it. May I not disparage the great ones of the past, many of them speaking from divine knowledge have given great gifts to the world. But I do think that Meher Baba, as the avatar in this age, when the different civilizations are together, gave a knowledge and an understanding that really has not been there before. There have been pieces of it. There have been hints and intimations many times. And of course, in the givings of some of these great ones, infinite depth is there. God can be found there in his entirety. I'm not, you know, negating any of that. But as an account of creation, God and creation, I really do feel that God speaks is quite matchless. Baba gave it in the way that the Avatar does. It's not a work of systematic philosophy or anything of the sort. You know, any theologian or philosopher who came up with 1/10,000th of the content that Baba did would write 40 books about it and develop it and explain it in every little aspect. But Baba's manner of presenting his revealed truth is not like that. It's his own unique style. You find it in God Speaks with that repetitiveness, that sonorous voice that resonates throughout the whole thing. Sometimes it's one feels as though Baba's just repeating himself, or that I don't get it. The style is quite unique to him, as far as I can see. So he doesn't present his content in the way that philosopher or intellectual would. And one of the consequences of that, in my experience, is that I've had to unpack it or sound it more and more deeply as I myself, you know, mature through life and come to a deeper understanding, as such as it is in Baba. And it keeps reaching points where you actually go quite beyond the intellect, and it seems like glimmers from something beyond the intellect keep coming. At least that's my experience of it. God Speaks, I feel, is the master framework that Meher Baba gave. Is it too dark, by the way?
Yeah, I was just about to say, should we put the lights on?
Or else we want to lift that up. We did this so that, in fact, let's get the man on the screen.
Let's get in the way of the screen.
Actually, that seems fine to me. That doesn't seem to vitiate at all.
Which way? On or off?
Off. Leave this one on.
Just one on.
Yeah.
Good.
What I was saying is escaped my mind. What was I talking about?
God
Speaks.
The quality approach, please.
Yeah.
His sonorous style.
Yeah, that manner of explaining things and completely vanished from my mind now. Okay.
You know, how you were talking about sort of seeing beyond the intellect and glimpses, the way that it presents it, the book.
Yes.
Yeah. Could you say more about that?
Yeah, I found that also with Infinite Intelligence, and I certainly find it with God Speaks that one of the criticisms people will direct, if not to God Speaks, than to people who like God Speaks, is that this is just intellectualism. And Baba, you know, is approached through love. And I'm certainly, you know, Meher Baba himself would often say, oh, these discourses give me a headache, or you don't try to understand me, just love me. There's no doubt that Baba's emphasis was on approaching him through love. But I don't myself feel that this is necessarily something apart from the path of love, because the kind of revelation that God Speaks gives involves the understanding and the intellect, to be sure, But there's something way beyond that that keeps revealing itself. You know, Don Stevens has that story where Baba had said to him that in his books and in his writings there are these atom bombs of energy. And I'm a big believer in the atom bombs. I don't know if I've experienced an atom bomb. I don't know if I'm big enough for that. But bombs, for sure, I can tell you that. There's very great, an illuminative power in them to awaken the mind. It's sort of like what the faculty that needs to come into use in the proper reading of God Speaks, I would call mind-heart. It's actually both. That's my experience of it. Certainly, the thinking mind is very much in play. But just with that won't be enough. There's a kind of a vision, a kind of a seeing that it awakens. Anyway, so that's my experience of God Speaks over the years.
Yeah. What about the notion that the purest and greatest world scriptures, just the arrangement of the words themselves will do the trick? In other words, all you have to do is read it or recite it mentally. The way, does that?
Yeah.
Are you familiar with that notion?
I've heard that, and it could well be true. I don't know. But I do think that just to read God Speaks, one will get great benefit, even if you don't understand it. And I also think this. A lot of Baba lovers will say, I read God Speaks, and I don't understand it. Well, you know, I think that a lot of people actually have understood it better than they think. And certainly major themes really have come through. For example, the very central theme in God Speaks, the divine theme, which is the journey of the soul, evolution, reincarnation, involution, for the realization of God. I think most people who have been associated with Baba for any length of time are acquainted with that. Isn't that true? Aren't you aware of that? Well, that's a real big one. And so far as I can see, that is a new revelation to the world from the avatar. In my readings of the great spiritual traditions, I haven't encountered that. I've seen hints of it. I've seen pieces of it. But the whole story of the journey of the soul, so far as I can see, has been told to humanity for the first time by the Father of Creation, Avatar Mirabhava, in this advent. So that is right at the center of what he had to give. It's almost like in this age of madness and confusion, where all the races of the world are meeting, the religions, the nationalities are meeting and clashing, and the old systems of belief are being seemingly discredited and rejected, and people don't know what to believe. It's as if the Ancient One himself has come to humanity to say, do you know who you are? Let me tell you who you are. It's like a story, one of these folk stories where, you know, there's a little boy who's actually the son of the king, who somehow gets separated and brought up by some poor, you know, fisherman or something like that, and wanders around the world, and in the end meets his father, who says, do you know who you are? You are my son. You are yourself the king. Baba has said that to all of humanity. The first time an avatar that I know of has ever said this with anything like this degree of clarity. And he's told us the story of our entire journey from the beginning till the end, that we were stones, we were metal, we were fish. That has not been explained. Am I wrong about this? Has anybody explained this before? I keep saying this, but I keep looking for the divine theme in the great writers, the great masters.
Isn't there that Rumi poem that goes, I was something and I became something?
Yeah, yeah. Is like a hint. I would call
that the teeniest
hint. And it's a hint that would be picked up by Baba lovers much more willingly than by most historians, to say the least. I mean, there are things like that, you know.
And wasn't there some that an Indian philosopher whose name just escapes me, who was contemporaneous with Barbara?
Like Aurobindo?
Yeah, who died.
Yeah, like you'll get, in Aurobindo, there's an evolutionary account of history and civilization. I'm not enough of an expert to know that I don't think with him you have the individualized soul going through that whole journey.
I didn't read it so much.
So I haven't seen that anywhere. Mm. And Baba's account of the dropped soul originating from the whim of God and gathering consciousness through the accumulation of sanskaras, that whole account, which is so exquisitely simple, actually. I don't know it. John, have you ever heard of anything like this before?
No.
It seems like it's quite new. And that's when I read Meher Baba would say, oh, these discourses give me a headache. In a way, it makes me laugh because you would get the impression that Baba himself is dismissing his own books or his own teachings and might lead one to think there's nothing much there. And of course, a lot of this is to love him, to remember to love him. That's what really matters. But there is a lot there. It's spectacular what we do find in his teaching, especially God Speaks. Now, over these sessions, God Speaks will be the center of attention, and we'll define the basic framework of the organization of all of this. But I'll bring in other things from time to time also. In fact, in the fundamental plan, this weekend is intended to go through God Speaks in and of itself more. And next weekend, we'll explore some special topics using God Speaks, but very much bringing other things into the picture too. As some of you may know, my own work has focused especially on Baba's explanations from the 1920s. That's kind of my specialization. Infinite Intelligence, this book Tiffin Lectures will be coming out later this year, and there are other bodies of explanation Meher Baba gave. So naturally I have a lot of interest in it. So next weekend, I was going to bring some of that into a relationship with God Speaks. I do think that Infinite Intelligence especially needs integration with God Speaks. It gives dimensions of the truth that you wouldn't know just from reading God Speaks alone. So here are the particular, I'll just read out a little bit of this. This was circulated by email, and some of you may have copies in your hands. God Speaks is Meher Baba's magnum opus in the literary and philosophical domain. As an avataric revelation, no other account of God and creation in the mystical literature of the East or West can rival it. At least that's my opinion, on basis of what I've read. Undoubtedly, God Speaks will serve as the major foundation in centuries to come whenever man tries to bring the powers of mind and heart to an understanding of his place in the cosmos in relation to the supreme reality. Now, these are some of the... Let me read through the particular topics of the different sessions. This is this morning. God Speaks in its historical context. God Speaks in the context of Meher Baba's life and teachings. The first and second editions of God Speaks. You know, there are two major editions of God Speaks. Probably most of you have the second one. And a projected third, an uncompleted edition by Francis Brabazon. Some of you, are you aware of that? I'm sure some of you would be. A history of the divine theme in Meher Baba's discourse. The organization and content of the three passes through the divine theme in the course of God Speaks, and the sections of the book. And then, if we get to this morning, you probably won't, laying part one, which lays some of the major foundations for the whole book. okay, to have this afternoon, Evolution, Reincarnation, and the Structure of Bondage. So this focuses on parts 2 to 4. In God Speaks, the chapters are called parts, and there are 10 chapters or 10 parts. Parts 2 to 4 of God Speaks, which detail the evolution of consciousness and the cycle of reincarnation. We'll get up to that point of the divine theme this afternoon. The divine theme is comprised of a movement of descent to human form and a subsequent ascent back to God. Evolution and reincarnation comprise the first half of this story, and the Jivatma achieves the state of greatest alienation from the God Self that is its source. Human form is the point of greatest alienation from God before it's overcome through the involutionary process, which is tomorrow morning. The Involution of Consciousness, a study of parts 5, 6, and 7, which describe the involutionary journey of ascent from the ordinary gross conscious man state to the realization of God from different angles of vision. Chapters 5, 6, and 7, each of them treats involution, but in a different way. Part 5 provides a basic account of the seven planes. Part 6 describes the states of higher consciousness. And Part 7 explains the structure of the veil. This is the Sufi figure of the veil across the face of the beloved. The involutionary journey concludes and culminates in the realization of God, which represents the completion and consummation of the divine theme. So somebody who really gets the most from what all this has to offer will become God realized by the end of tomorrow morning. So this is what we're doing. Okay, and then tomorrow afternoon, I'll say this now, as I understand it, a fundamental organization of God Speaks is this. It has 10 parts or 10 chapters. The first is a laying of foundations, and the last is a kind of a palinode or retraction in the Avatar's own style. So here's the chapters 2 through 9 are the heart of the book. As I understand it, God Speaks goes through the story of the divine theme three times specifically. I'm calling them the three passes through the divine theme. The first, it's a little bit more elaborated than this. This is a simplified version of this. The first, and you know what the divine theme is, right? The creation, evolution, reincarnation, involution, and realization. That's the story of the journey of the soul from beginning to end, which, as I say, appears to be something that the Avatar has revealed to humanity for the first time in its complete unfoldment. So God Speaks goes through that story three times specifically. And I think this is really helpful, because a lot of times people will say, God Speaks, it repeats itself. Yeah, it does, actually. But these three passes through the divine theme are very different from each other. Baba is bringing in very different perspectives. So the first pass through the divine theme happens in chapters 2 through 7. And actually, part 8 is, I think, as long as chapters 2 to 7 put together. It's like 70 or 80 pages long. It's a vast chapter. And that is the second pass through the divine theme. Baba starts over again with the whim of God and begins a second time. Okay, it's the second pass in cosmic architecture in God Speaks. Part 8 of God Speaks, which comprises almost 2/5 of the main text, comprises a second pass through the divine theme, but this time with a special orientation toward what we could call cosmic architecture. special attention will be devoted to the everything. These are some of the great themes in the cosmic architecture. This is the architecture of creation itself. The everything and the nothing. I think the greatest treatment of this theme in Mirababa's teachings happens here, although there are other important treatments too. God's triune nature as knowledge, power, and bliss. God's three aspects as creator, preserver, and destroyer. God's three states as wakefulness, dream, and sound sleep. Fana and Baka and the spiritual hierarchy. So that's quite a agenda there, huh? Mm-hmm. So there are these great trinities. And this, okay, and I'll, let me jump to the very last day, even though, because actually, this is part of the basic treatment of God Speaks Too. This will be a week from tomorrow, the final session, the 10 states of God, which is chapter 9 of God Speaks. I feel it's the most important single summary of Meher Baba's teachings, his philosophy. We don't have a good English word for this, teaching philosophy, wretched words. Actually, I've started to use the word darshana, and maybe I'll inflict this on you when I have a chance to explain it. But it's the most important, I feel, single summary of Meher Baba's darshana, his teachings. So the ninth part, it was actually written by Erich, who's the nominal author. The ninth part of God Speaks on the 10 states of God represents what is probably the most important synoptic account of Meher Baba's philosophy. This final session will be devoted to review of this most key chapter in God Speaks. So that will be... Now let me look then at next weekend, some of these special topics I wanted to bring up. So the basic skeleton will be, you know, the first pass this afternoon and tomorrow morning with evolution, reincarnation, and involution in chapters, parts 2 to 7. Then tomorrow afternoon, the second great pass in part 8, which is about 80 pages long or so. And then the final session will be the 10 states of God, which I take to be the third pass through the divine theme. You get what I'm, when I say a pass through the divine theme, you know what I'm talking about. In other words, the story of the journey of the soul is told again by Baba. He starts over and tells it again. Now, next weekend, Saturday morning, infinite intelligence and an integrated cosmology of Meher Baba's teachings. Let's say a first attempt to approach the question. Obviously, you won't fully succeed in integrating Meher Baba's cosmology next weekend, unless some of you are formidable in your contributions to our discussion. Infinite intelligence provides an account of certain cosmological principles, such as thinking, the imagination. Were any of you part of the infinite intelligence seminars we had 2 years ago? I don't know, you may remember thinking, the imagination, you recall that phrase. We'll go over that again. The universal individual macrocosm, microcosm relation, the division of the universe into the gross, subtle, and the fine, and the three conscious states of sound, sleep, dream, wakefulness that need to be integrated and interrelated with God Speaks and Meher Baba's teachings from later decades. This session will try to articulate an integrated cosmology of Meher Baba's teachings. I've got to rewrite that. In other words, it will be a first attempt to look into that topic. So in other words, some of the major material from the 1920s will be brought into relation with God Speaks. And then Saturday afternoon, Meher Baba's creation narrative. In God Speaks, Meher Baba provides a masterful account of the creation process originating in the surging of the original whim and God's primordial question, who am I? But in infinite intelligence and other discourse material from the 1920s, Baba outlined other elements in the story particularly in the interaction between space and energy, prana and akash. And have any of you ever encountered prana and akash? There's a little bit in infinite intelligence. And there's a lot more in some of this other material, whose separation and subsequent clash gave rise to the first form. In this session, we'll try to articulate a more complete creation narrative based on this greater suite of literary sources. It turns out that there's a lot more to creation than Baba chose to explain in God Speaks. And then Sunday morning, on the human form, I keep running into this in Baba's books. Meher Baba has said that the human form is the only form in creation. I've never seen that before said by any other master. Have you? There's only one form, and it's the human form, in various degrees of unfoldment. Like a stone, Baba said, is actually, it has the complete human form, but it's all folded in intact. He said it's like a rag doll. Yeah. In this session, well, I would think this would be very relevant in the future, things like medicine, fields like that, physiology. In this session, we will study the archetypal human form in its relation to what could be called subtle physiology, which is to say, microcosm-macrocosm correspondences, the human form in evolution and involution, the structure of the self, as explained in Meher Baba's 1943 booklet, Divine Theme, the relation between the perfect man, al-insan al-kamal, that's the Sufi term for it, and the five presences, and the different types of God-realized persons, or Shivatmas. So I know this is quite a package here. So we'll be going through this over the next 8 sessions. Want to bring up anything right now? Yeah.
This sounds like pass one through Ward Park's teaching that we've just had. You obviously picked up more than just metaphysics from God Speaks, but the methodology of teaching in God Speaks as well.
Well, we'll see what you all have to gain from it.
When's that pass out?
Yeah. I keep thinking that there should be at the doors as you come in baskets of vegetables, and if you don't like it, you can sort of say it with a tomato. Perhaps I shouldn't suggest this. Yeah. No, but I don't want this to be over people's head. When we're going through this, it may sound formidable. Does it sound formidable? But, you know, I really do want to take the time to go over things and make sure that you're finding it understandable and interesting, too. So this is the greater picture. So this weekend is kind of going through the God Speaks, but in its various chapters. And next weekend, we'll look at some of these greater themes in their relation to God Speaks and other material, too. That's the overall idea. Okay? So, let's see what happens if I was having trouble with this earlier. This session is actually looking at the biographical and textual history of God Speaks. You know, one of the dimensions of study of a literary work is to look at how it was created, the historical, biographical context in which it was created. And so that's what a lot of we'll be doing right now. How did God Speaks kind of be composed in the first place? Now, I wanted to take, let's do a just a glance through Baba's lifetime and some of the discourse material he gave out over the course of those times. There seem to be certain periods where Baba was very prolific in giving out of discourse material, certain phases. The ones that really stand out in my mind would be the 1920s, then the period when he was dictating the discourses, 1938 to 1942, and then the 1950s. There were other, you know, things too, but those were especially rich. Now in the 1920s, we have a whole group of bodies of material. First of all, there's the book itself, which I keep hoping someone will provide so that we can publish it and have it read. So,
you know, everybody else.
Yeah. And so Baba wrote that with his own hand starting on 13th July 1925. Do you notice anything about that date? Yes. When did he begin his silence attack?
10th
of July. So 3 days after beginning his silence, he started to write the book in the Jhopadi. You know the Jhopadi at Mehrabad, that little hut there? That's where he, and he wrote it in various places. He sometimes the table cabin, sometimes in the water tank, which later became the tower, the retreat on the hill. And there was a little cabin also in a building called the Saidarbar. He would go to different places and be very, he liked small confined spaces. And so he finished it up in November 1926, or maybe December 1926. Now, maybe you happen to, anything strike you about that date in terms of the technology of Mirabhava's communication? Do you happen to know what happened on the 2nd of January 1927?
Slides too often.
Huh?
Slides too often. Slides too often.
That's right. He gave up writing on slate. And for a while, he would just point to letters and newspapers until Vishnu and came up with the idea of creating an alphabet board. So the writing of the book coincided exactly with the period that Baba was writing. And he actually mentioned that the book will have great force because I gave up writing right after finishing it. So that's one major work that we really know nothing about. In God's Hand, a lot of you would have seen that. It's actually 39 pages in Baba's own handwriting. We think it was written in 1925. We think it might be August 1925. Infinite Intelligence, in my opinion, is a record of a dictation Baba gave during the same period, probably from about March till about July 1926. And somebody wrote it down and wrote it up. So that's just an opinion. It's an unsigned manuscript. But I'm quite solidly convinced of this. Infinite Intelligence is a work on Light God Speaks. Of the various writings attributable to Mirabhava, it's the work most Light God Speaks because it's a long, sustained treatise on high philosophical subjects, I guess you could say. Tiffin Lectures is a manuscript with discourses Baba gave to his mandali, and they're all dated April 29th, 1926 to August 30th, 1927. So this is like the spiritual training of the mandali. It's specifically for the men mandali. And this will be coming out later this year. There's another really interesting manuscript, Sri's Explanation on Creation and the Universe. And these are talks to the Meher Ashram boys. Now, the Meher Ashram was the boys' school Baba created in 1927. And some of you would be familiar with the Prem Ashram, right? That came out of the Meher Ashram because there was this eruption, this explosion of love that happened among a certain number of the boys in the school. Some of you will have met Svendyar Vasale. Did you meet Svendyar Vasale? He was, did he come here? A lot of people got to know him. He died maybe 5 or 6 years ago. And he was one of the Pramashram boys. Wonderful, wonderful, amazing stories he would tell. Actually, Alava was not in the Pramashram. He was just in the Mirashram. That whole thing didn't happen to him until later. So Baba gave these talks between the 2nd of December and the 14th of January to this group of boys. And right in the middle of that period, this thing happened, this explosion of love happened. In fact, the very week that it happened, Baba was telling them all about the planes of consciousness. And within a few days, a bunch of these kids were on the planes of consciousness. So I don't know whether the Australian school system is as effective as this. Baba says, third plane is like this. And he said, yes, sir. Zoom! Third plane. And it's an amazing episode, actually. So that's a whole body of material that will get published as soon as we can get to it. And also, a lot of this content got published in a magazine, the Meher Message, that came out on a monthly basis over this 3-year period, until the editor left Baba and started denouncing Baba, and the whole thing went down in flames, and that ended that. So this is a lot of stuff, and it's most of it never really properly or fully got published at that time, although it looks like there were movements towards its publication. In fact, in 1929, Baba created a committee, I think it's called Divine Knowledge Publishers. Isn't that funny? And with Chanji was going to work in Gujarati, Ramju was going to work in Urdu, Manokar in Marathi, Dastur in English, and Rasab in Persian. And so there was a vision towards collecting all of this, I presume. All I know is the committee was there, but getting all of this material together and working it up into published form, that's what I would guess that they were thinking of. But it never happened at the time, because Baba got the notion to start going to the West in 1931, and then everything, will you pardon my saying, got dumbed down. It got built up again. But his teachings got enormously simplified when he went to the West. It took on different sorts of themes and a different sort of focus, actually. It became very simple. But then he built it up again with the discourses. So all this early stuff kind of got buried and lost for a long time, in the main part. So this was one early great phase. And,
Would the second last one, Sri's explanation, when you say it's a large body of work, what dimensions are you talking about?
Well, this is not all that big, but it's really, really substantial. It's about maybe 80 typed pages or something. But I'll tell you, it packs a punch. It really, the great philosophers are going to be amazed in the future. Yeah.
Part of the Meher Ashram boys, is that covered in parts in Francis's book, The Silent Word?
I think so. I don't recall that he says all that much about it. The attention tends to go to the Premashram because of what the extraordinary things that were happening with some of those. They started weeping for days together, and all these things happened. But that was actually only a group of, I don't know, 20 or 30, I'm not sure how many, out of 100 or so. So most of them stayed in the Meher Ashram, which was a school. They were getting education in various subjects at the time. So I'm sure Francis, does anybody happen to remember in The Silent Word? He mentions it in Stay With God in his biographical section there. And there was a lot of other stuff by other people. I'm just going to pass over that for now. Now, in the 1930s, when Meir Baba started going to the West, he gave out certain messages, and they were collected in this book, Early Messages to the West. A lot of people don't really know about this book, published 8 or 9 years ago, but it's a collection of this material. And in 1933 in particular, some of Baba's mandalis started publishing books. There's a book called The Sayings of Sri Meher Baba and Questions and Answers of Meher Baba. So, and there were more books in under contemplation. But a really major body, the first really substantial public body of published literature came out with starting in 1938 with the publication of the Meher Baba Journal. Now I imagine a lot of you would be acquainted with that. It was very much overseen by Meher Baba himself. The Meher message Baba kind of stood aloof from, but the Meher Baba Journal, he organized the editorial committee. He checked all the material that went. We have lists from Buzz and Wendy in Myrtle Beach of articles, and they'd be ticked off by Baba before going into the Meher Baba Journal. And the most important body of material in it is Baba's discourses, most of which were published in the Meher Baba Journal first, one per issue. It came out once a month, so there were 48 issues before it discontinued publication. And there were a bunch of discourses, apparently, which hadn't been published yet, and they got included into the complete edition of discourses. So that those are real masterpieces. I mean, I know lots of you know them well. In the 40s, then, after that, Baba didn't give out a whole lot of other material. There were occasional messages here and there. In 1949, Baba left Mirzabad, closed down the ashram, broke off his associations with everybody, and went on the new life. So we have, and the only link between him and his old life disciples were these circulars. And some of them do contain material from Baba himself, dictations of his. But they're a very interesting and significant body of stuff. But probably the most important phase of all came in the 1950s, and first place in that body of stuff is God Speaks Itself, published in 1955. The discourses got republished. Anyway, Your Life at Its Best, Listen Humanity, Beings, and a lot of really major messages, universal message, the final declaration, things like that. Some of the most important messages came out right at the period where Baba declared himself to be the avatar of the age. And in the 1960s, we have the Everything and the Nothing, but Baba didn't really give out much material for publication then. So these are some of the great phases. God Speaks represents really a culmination of the philosophical material. A lot of the themes in it can be found earlier. Infinite Intelligence has some of it, and the discourses do too. But God Speaks presents it in a developed form that you really won't find anywhere else. So this is the broader literary context in which God Speaks appears. Now, here are some of the particular history of God Speaks Itself, and I just took a lot of this from Ira Dietrich's account of God Speaks, the story of God Speaks. I think when you buy God Speaks now, a copy of it, it's tucked in the back somewhere. Do some of you have that? I don't see it here, actually, even in these new copies. But Baba started dictating God Speaks to Dr. Ghani in what was intended, well, it later became God's speech. Just prior to this, seemingly not by coincidence, Baba had Dr. Ghani read Hafiz's ghazals to him from late evening until 4 a.m. for 21 days. Ghani appeared to be progressing more slowly than Baba wished in turning the material Baba dictated into a manuscript. For in February 1948, Baba dictated an agreement that he made Dr. Ghani sign before witnesses, promising to finish the book by the end of May 1948. Even this wasn't sufficient to goad Ghani out of his lazy ways, because by November 1948, Ghani had still not finished the book. Baba continued dictating additional points. I don't know, are some of you familiar with Dr. Ghani? And he was brilliant and very, very audacious and clever and witty and world-class lazy, you know. I remember Erich telling the story during this period when Baba sent him, Erich, to get Ghani for something. And Ghani wasn't able to finish up the work because he was too busy, you know. He never had enough time. So Baba said, well, what do you need? So Ghani said, well, I need a valet. Right? This is kind of the Mandalay, right? Getting your own valet. So Baba actually provided him with one. So Erich went in this one day, and it was the middle of the day, and Ghani sound asleep. And he was so lazy that when he would go to sleep, he would always wear a suit and tie. And he wouldn't even take it off, because if he did, he would have to put it on again when he got up, and he was too lazy to do that. So there he was, in his suit and tie, sound asleep. And the valet was sitting there, obviously under instructions, on a chair with Ghani's toothbrush and toothpaste. He put on the toothbrush. And Eric's like, I couldn't believe it. He was too lazy even to put his own toothpaste on the toothbrush. He was really a great character. When in the 70s, when I was first getting to know Usama the Madali, where I asked Erich, what was Ghani like? And Erich said, Ghani was the very living embodiment of everything that we weren't supposed to be. But then he told various stories, but then Erich said, but all this was on the surface. He was a priceless gem. That's the thing. That's really the truth. But unfortunately, he never finished this. I would love to see his notes, what Baba had dictated to him. Because when it came to this kind of subject, Ghani knew it better than anybody. He was brilliant, and he was very interested in these subjects, and he was the master of, among the Mandali, of Sufism. He really knew Sufi literature, and he would get Baba to say things by making some kind of an outrageous remark. And Baba would, you know, rebut it, and in the course of it, give a discourse, and Ghani would do all of this on purpose. So he was really, there are so many wonderful stories about him. So during the period when Baba was dictating to Ghani, Ivy Deuce visited Baba for the first time, and Baba arranged for Ghani to be present. Dr. Ghani was a Sufi, and Ivy Deuce was the Murshid of Sufism in America. During this visit, Dr. Ghani went over a lot of Murshid Idus's Sufi papers and so forth. In other words, Baba created a link between Ghani and Sufism reoriented. And until Ghani died, that was the major channel through which communication happened. Now, Dr. Ghani died during the New Life. He was actually one of the New Life companions. And he was the one who organized a strike during the New Life against Baba. Maybe you've heard that story. He was quite a character. He was really a wonderful guy, actually. But he would do things no one else would dream of doing, like having a strike in the New Life. But he passed away, and after the New Life, Baba got his material together. And during an interview with Ivy Deuce and Francis Brabazon, that's where Francis first met Baba, was in Myrtle Beach in 1952. Baba asked Murshida, "Did you see my chart, the 10 states of God?" It would seem that this chart, the 10 states of God, was the first element of God Speaks that Baba created. And the book may have started with that. And I dictated all the points to Dr. Ghani. He worked on it. And now I find half of it has not been included. Half has been just as I wanted. I brought the manuscript here. And when I'm free, I'll go through the whole thing and make necessary changes. The book will be the first and last of its kind. Today I will show you just the chart on which the book is based. And when it is ready, I might hand it over to you for publication. So Baba apparently brought up the topic with Ivy Deuce up in 1952. I gather that Baba also gave a copy of the manuscript to Charles Purdom. So it wasn't altogether clear at first who would edit the book. Let's see. This is Baba's tribute, where he says, "Of all the things I had to renounce and suffer in this new life, the passing of Ghani is among the greatest." And Baba said, "But this sudden wrenching away of Ghani is a disaster for me. To me, more than to any of you, Ghani was unique. And of all the work that still remains to be done for me by others, there is much that could have been done for me by Ghani and by no one else. That big head of his was truly a treasure house in which wisdom and wit were blended to perfection," and so forth. Baba really had a deep love for him. And it's a real tragedy that we don't have this book as he would have done it. And in August of 1953, Baba began dictating God Speaks to Erich Jesawala. I remember Erich talking about this. Do any of you recall? He would take dictation during the day, and then at night, he would write up what Baba had given him. And because all he was in the room with the other men, Mandali, and they were all, you know, talking and carrying on and making a ruckus, and so that he could work undistracted, he would take a blanket over his head with a lantern. I don't know how he managed not to suffocate himself, and would write it all out and then read it back to Baba the next day. So Baba was very serious about it. Baba started over, all over from the very beginning. You know, a couple of years ago, Marilyn, Jesawala, and I found what looks like the record of the dictation of the first chapter of God Speaks. And it was in Pandu's handwriting. Bao recalled that the very beginning, Erich would read out Baba's gestures and Pandu wrote it down. But very quickly, Erich started writing it down. Pandu actually hated stuff like this. He could not stand philosophy or such. It was probably torture for him, and Baba let him off to the hook after one chapter. But get this, it's in Gujarati. The first chapter, at least, was in Gujarati. So who knows, maybe the whole thing was dictated in Gujarati, I don't know. The first chapter was, it looks like. But Erich completed his writing work in July, and Bao organized it into chapters and got it typed up at that time. In 1954, a group of Western men were invited to be with Baba at what's known as the Three Incredible Weeks, which culminated in Baba's final declaration at the end of that month. Actually, Francis was there, and of course, Led Dimful. Francis, as most of you would know, had been a Sufi under the Baron and under Rabia Martin and under Ivy Deuce. But Baba, anyway, that came to an end when he met Baba. And although he always maintained a cordial relation with Ivy Deuce, as far as I'm aware. but he wasn't a Sufi anymore. But Lud Dimphal was. So Lud Dimphal was given the manuscript to present to Murshid Idus and Don Stevens to correct the grammar and punctuation and prepare for printing. And the following letter was given. And I think this is from, I'm sorry, I didn't put down, it might be from Mani. Dear Ivy, this is to, no, that's from Marriage. It's to explain the enclosed manuscript. And no, I think it is from Mani. Notes and articles which Baba wishes you and Don Stevens to work on in collaboration. As you will note, there are two separate packages. The file marked number one contains notes and articles dictated personally by Baba, taken down and worked on by Erich. The packet marked packet number two is the incomplete manuscript of Dr. Gandhi's book that he was working on years ago, and which was revised by Dr. Donkett by Baba's orders. You know William Donkett, right? The author of Wayfarers, who I think was a superb writer. Just wonderful. I would rank him and Francis as the two best in Baba's. One is my belief. The final typing suspended for want of clarification on many points, which could only be done by Baba himself. This was indefinitely postponed by the coming of the new life phase, during which Baba stopped answering any and all questions on spiritual subjects. Because Baba at that time had stepped down from his God state and would not have professed to have spiritual knowledge. Hence, manuscript number two is far from final, was composed by Dr. Gandhi on points and notes given by Baba, revised by Dr. Donkin, still has irrelevancies and discrepancies, and also has many very good and interesting points. Baba wishes you to take as the main foundation for God Speaks manuscript number one, dictated personally by Baba. Leaving the sense in its entirety, he wants you and Don to make grammatical corrections, change the English of, alter the formation of any sentence or para you like, delete unnecessary repetitions, etc., etc. In short, present Baba's work in the best way you can. Take from manuscript number two any point, article, or chapter you like and think good. Correct any discrepancy you may come across in Sufi terminology in Gandhi's book that you may wish to use. In short, take whatever you like from Gandhi's work to add to Baba's manuscript number one for the book. Then send to Baba the revised manuscript with any questions you may have. Baba will have it read out to him and will return the final to you for printing. You are allowed to write to him in regard to the book, and Baba will clarify any point that is doubtful or not clear. So these are the instructions Sufis were given.
Yeah. Do we still have those manuscripts?
I would love to know, and at some point I'll try to ask the Sufis or maybe a group could. I'd like to see. I've been given to understand over the years is that the first batch of material alluded to here is what comprises the main text of God Speaks, chapters 1 through 10. And the second batch of material comprises the supplement. I find it hard to believe that that's the complete story, though, because the supplement doesn't have anything remotely like an early draft of God Speaks. There's nothing like that there. What do some of you think? If Baba said, I dictated to Gandhi and half of it is just as I wanted, but he left a lot out. Well, the supplement doesn't have anything like God Speaks in it. And a lot of the material that I would attribute to Gandhi would not have come from Baba. I can't believe that at all. So I would like to know the full story of that and whether Gandhi's material is in fact available somewhere.
Do you sense the Sufis would have that information? Should we organize a raid or something?
Well, I've personally never even asked them, so maybe I'll try to bring it up. But I'd like to see what they actually have. Or maybe it got lost or destroyed or something. I don't know. Yeah, maybe it's with the book. Whoever has got the book, when you bring it out, bring this material out too at the same time. If Baba was dictating God Speaks, we would have a body of material very different from anything that's in that supplement there. The supplement, I'm not disparaging the supplement, though. There's a lot there that's very, very interesting and very significant. It's quite different from God Speaks. Now, in 1955, God Speaks was published. I think it came out in November. And the news of it was conveyed to the attendees at this 1955 Sahabas. Back in 2005 at Mirabad, we had a 50th anniversary commemorative event of that 1955 Sahabas, and a bunch of the attendees of the original Sahabas came and told their stories of their times there, and it was really, really wonderful. There were four different language groups. Actually, Listen Humanity recounts that story. The first part of Listen Humanity recounts that story because Don Stevens and Francis were the two Westerners invited to attend. And each of them, Baba asked to write a book. And in Don's case, that materialized as Listen Humanity. And in Francis's case, it came out in 1959 as Stay With God. So two real blockbusters were the products of the two Westerners who attended this event. And in the series, there were four different language groups, 1 week each, so that they could not have to be translating into multiple languages. I think there was a Gujarati, Telugu, Hindi, English. I may be wrong. I've forgotten to tell the truth. But Baba, at this, emphasized the importance and unique nature of God Speaks. In his instructions to the attendees, Baba said, "I want you all to take particular note that I would feel happy if each one of you not only possessed, but read and digested God Speaks from the first to the last page as the last book of its kind by me. I will likewise be happy if those among you who can possibly do so will see that this work is translated and made available in as many languages as possible for those who cannot read and understand English." So we have at least one person here, Tian, who's been engaged in that. Anyone else? Has it been translated into Australian yet? It worked. Baba says, "You will find God Speaks a very unique book. Never before have such things been disclosed by me. You will understand through your mind the why and wherefore of your being." It really strikes me that this historical coincidence that God Speaks was published in the very month that this Sahabas was going on. Because in the Sahabas, Baba kept saying, "I'm not going to give explanations. I'm not going to give discourses. This is the time for intimate Sahabas, give and take." It wasn't a darshan. It was a Sahabas between the lover and the beloved. You know, personal intimacy between him and his close ones. So you might say this was one of the apexes of personal time with Baba for a greater group of his lovers, apart from just his intimate mandali. I have a hard time thinking of another occasion for a body of his lovers like this. Well, some of the Sahabases in Australia and America would have been similar. At the exact same historical moment comes out God Speaks, which is the supreme statement of, you might say, the impersonal aspect of God, the highest philosophy and the greatest intimacy between lover and beloved happened at the very same moment, November 1945. Anyway, I'm really struck by that. So it's like those two opposites were both came into manifestation right at that very same time. We have God speaks and then listen humanity and a state of God, all vitally related to this very same period. And actually, Baba said of state of God that it gives life to God speaks. Now, that was the first edition. Any of you who have a first edition, by the way, keep track of it and don't lose it. They're valuable. You know, you don't want to continue to have a supply of them. But very soon, Baba started to indicate there would be other editions too. And as early as 1956, Baba wrote to Murshid Adus about, this is all from Ira Dietrich's account again, suggestions for future editions of God Speaks. Among them was the following in a letter from Mani that February. Now, one thing Baba wants you to do for future editions, and that is to add at the end of the book his previous article, Existence is Substance and Life is Shadow. So when you read that, that was asked for by Baba. It's a little bit hard to find, actually. It is there, though. This should appear at the complete end of the supplement, sealing the book, as he put it. So that's a message Baba specifically wanted. Also, there are a bunch of charts in the second edition which did not appear in the first, including that great chart of Ranos. I have it in another slide. We'll show it. It's not up here anywhere, is it?
No.
Anyway, I'll show it and you'll recognize it, showing, you know, the gas, the forms of evolution, and then the big long line of reincarnation, and then the spheres of involution of the realization of God. There we go. There it is. If you can see that. That wasn't in the first edition, and a number of other really important charts weren't. They got added as time went on. During his seclusion in 1967, Baba worked on editions and revisions for a second edition of God Speaks. In 1967, Murshid Adus wrote Baba saying she would like to include a glossary of Sufi and Vedantic mystic terms in the second edition. Just yesterday, we had a session on Vedanta. So, you know, we're all beefed up and expert on the Vedantic vocabulary at the moment. Baba approved, and Lud Dinful worked on it. In the fall of 1967 at Guru Prasad, Baba was checking and correcting a glossary of God Speaks, which Lud Dinful had prepared. Balna too would read out every word and its meaning, and when required, Baba would correct a point. Lud included a chart he had drawn, lining up all the stages of the spiritual path, and included it with the glossary when it was sent. In 1969, this would be at the Great Darshan, then, Erich gave everything back to Lud with Baba's corrections and informed Lud that Baba wanted both the chart and the glossary included in the next edition of God Speaks. And this is that. I have a slide or two, but this is that chart that you would find in, if you don't lose it, these charts have a way of falling out and getting lost. Chart 11. I must say, I myself am quite impressed by it. And the job that I did. So those elements appear to have been added with Baba's very explicit approval. So, and there's a whole batch of correspondence between Erich and Ivy and Lud Dinful after Baba dropped the body on particular passages for inclusion and particular edits, too. So far as I can, as I was able to ascertain, Erich really did sign on to everything that happened. In 1969, at the last Darshan, Erich gave Murshid Adus all the corrections and suggestions from Baba for the second edition. On November 15, 1969, Erich wrote, "Today I have posted you by registered airmail etc. A file of 121 pages plus charts of all suggestions and changes for the second edition of God Speaks. I shall post one more file, an extra one, after a day or two to ensure such safe delivery. The files, two copies I have sent, now contain up-to-date suggestions and all necessary changes and corrections, plus additions and corrected glossary and charts. Therefore, to keep the old file would be useless and confusing, I have destroyed mine. All the archivists may now swoon. This would be absolutely impermissible nowadays, but that's actually, when they were compiling the original edition of the Quran, they were of Erich's mind. They had a kind of a Quran committee. I don't suppose they called it that, but that's sort of what it was. And they got all the different versions of it, and they selected what they thought was the most authentic, and they destroyed all the other versions. Mm. That was the style back in those days. You don't do, I don't know, maybe you could take that under advisement for the Avatar's Abode archive collection. So the second edition, which was published after Mihirbhatta dropped the body in 1973, some people might be asking, well, why did they do that? How did they presume to come up with a new edition of the book? Well, Baba clearly wanted it and oversaw a lot of the content that went into it, as far as I can see. But there's another chapter to this whole story involving your own Francis. It would seem that Baba asked Francis to do another edition of Don't Speaks. And I have a slideshow of this, but I don't know if it's readable. Can you get a We'll see how well this. It's kind of too small to read. Back in 2010, I think, when I was here, the trust allowed me to look through some of the archival material in the Avatar's Abode collection, and it turns out that you have a file of notes taken by Francis that were his direct record of dictations from Baba that were supposed to go into the making of a new edition of God Speaks. I'm afraid this is not going to be readable, but I had a PDF file which I could pull up, but when I tried to do it, the whole screen went blank on me for 20 minutes, and I was freaking out before it broke, so I'm afraid to try it again. But this is a direct transcript of from one of the files there. Let's see. This assignment from Baba, this is my introduction, is made entirely explicit in a note dated September 20th, 1967. There Francis writes, "In the revised edition of God Speaks, the present introduction is to be A, and a B is to be written by me. In B, the new introduction, I have to say that Mihirbhatta made me re-edit God Speaks without changing the facts, and also that Mihirbhatta gave important points to be added in the beginning of the book, and that I was helped by Erich." So there is a file of, I don't know, 150 pages, sometimes with just little scraps of notes. They're all dated. And I don't know whether Francis was fastidious in that way generally, or if Erich encouraged him to do it, but it's most helpful. So it seems 1967 to 68 or so, there are all these little points that Baba was giving that Francis was supposed to incorporate into a new edition of God Speaks. But unfortunately, most of them are in the nature of indications of topics that Francis should remind Baba to explain, but then it never happened. So after Francis came back here to Australia, it's probably the fault of all you Avatars About scoundrels who distracted him by insisting and wanting to know about Mir Baba and demanding his time from devoting himself properly. Roy, you're probably one of the chief culprits here, I guess. And they're very, John and others, instead of encouraging him just to leave you and work on God Speaks, which he never got done. Actually, I don't, do you have a defense of yourself to offer?
No, not at all. I mean, we're at his whim.
Were you guys aware that he was doing this?
No, not at all.
John might have been.
Yeah, he was supposed to be doing
it. No. I mean, we knew that there was some stuff he had to do, but he was clear about what it was.
He seems to have been very private about it. I couldn't find one single person who knew about this, actually. And Ivy Deuce did write to him in 1969, and then again in 1973, and he wrote back. And in the second letter, he sounds a bit bleak as to whether this could be done or not, saying that it doesn't really seem to be enough material to go on. And it looks like that to me. I don't see how it could be done, to tell the truth. It's like he would have had to go back over all these things with Baba to really finish this. But there is about maybe 15 or 20 pages in Francis's handwriting of a re-edit. And what he was doing was making the prose more readable, just exactly like those instructions here say. Without changing the fact. Maybe re-edit God Speaks without changing the fact. It's just more fluent and more eloquent, but doesn't change the meaning at all. So we do have about 15 or 20 pages of his that way. But then there are all these various notes, some of which are quite intriguing.
Ward, before you say that, can we just discuss that photo? There's a photo of Francis up the top.
Yeah.
Now, I'm almost certain I took that photograph outside Sydney. I took him out there to photograph him for when we were publishing Wind of the Word.
Oh.
And so it says that Avatar's Abode, and I just don't know how that happened.
But it's not Avatar's Abode at all, it's Sydney.
No, and the outskirts of Sydney.
Great.
Not that it's
good.
Yeah.
Okay.
Another filched photo, eh?
Yeah. Well, Sim lost them. There's a whole stack of them that have disappeared.
Oh.
On very good quality. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Yeah. 2.25 by 2.25 meters.
Yeah, really good.
Yeah.
He said he put them, filed them at Avatar's Abode, so if anyone ever finds them.
This one, you this don't
one
know where
them.
This one is either?
It's one of them.
It's one of them? Huh. Well, I have no idea where it came from myself. But here's one of those sorts of notes.
Yes.
I don't know if we can read it. I have a better. The whim which began the creation of the universe through the own point. Francis always wrote the that way. That same whim, after 14,000 million times 14,000 million years, absorbs everything. I can't read it, sorry.
Through the own point.
Huh? Through the own point. That's right, own point. Into the beyond state of God. But those in fifth, sixth planes go into the consciousness of the beyond state of God. After 14,000 million times 14,000 million years. And elsewhere it says just 14,000 million years, which would be 14 billion. Which does happen to be the age of the universe just now. So if that number is right, we could be having Mahapralaya any years now.
It's time.
But if it's 14,000 million times 14,000, well, we've got time still. And yeah, there's an interesting follow-up. I think it's on another page where he says more about this. Anyway, it's interesting if you find such things interesting, which I do for one. I don't know whether everyone does. But yeah, so he's talking about manifests after this. It sounds like he's talking about Mahapralaya here. And this is the only time I've ever seen a numeric time frame given for Mahapralaya, how often it happens. After 14,000 million years, again, the same whim manifests the creation. And after that time, again, the same whim manifests the creation. Did I read that right?
Yeah. Okay.
This something happens billions of times. This has happened billions of times because the eternity has no time. So get that. 14,000 million times 14,000 million. It happens once, and that has happened billions of times. I mean, the extent of creation, my God. But then he says, the difficult point to explain is the beginning of the first whim. How and when it got, I can't read it, sorry.
Got the urge,
yeah. So the thing is that after a Mahapralaya, everything reverts to the beyond state and then a new whim comes. So how did it happen the first time when there wasn't a beyond state, only a beyond beyond state? We'll explain this. that's what's so tantalizing. You know, this interesting question gets asked and then never answered here.
But the intriguing thing is that first has the foundation that it is linear.
Yeah.
But if it's not linear,
that's right.
Then actually there is no first.
I was thinking that very same thought, as a matter of fact. What do you think? Maybe we nailed it.
Somebody yeah. told me that Eric said in Mondali Hall, what about Mahapralaya?
Yeah.
And he said something like, well, it could have just happened. And here we all are again in this moment. Somebody told me that was his take on it. Has anybody ever heard Eric say that?
There is something about it in the Tiffin lectures that will come out. As a matter of fact, Baba said, at the time of Mahapralaya, he said that in November 1926. So there are a whole bunch of things like that. Let's see. Okay, I won't attempt to read any. But here is a list of topics. Yeah, there is on one sheet, Francis wrote a list of the different topics that Baba had given him points on at different times. The evolution of consciousness and bodies depend on samskaras, July 24th. The play of samskaras in madness, July 27th. All creation, evolution, reincarnation, and involution depend on samskaras, August 15th. Thick and thin samskaras, August 9th, and then another date. Shadow and shadows, the 18,000 inhabited worlds. By the way, this is, I found helpful, because there are contradictions on this. And God speaks, it says there are 18,000 worlds, but only three with human form. And elsewhere it says there are 18,000 with human form. Mm. This makes it quite unambiguous that it's 18,000 with human form. It's quite detailed on the matter. Billions of stars, 50,000 billions of points, substance and shadow, nature and habit, which is rather fascinating, gross impression, etc., etc. So these are the topics on which he had taken notes, yeah.
What did he mean by a point?
I can't remember. We have to look at it again. But these are just little short little things. Sometimes you can't completely understand them even. Some of it's very, very odd. It's a bit hard to see how this would fit into a new edition of God Speaks. It doesn't exactly relate to any of the chapters that are there that I can see. So it looks like Baba's work on all of this was really not finished, and he really wanted to go over it again with Francis, but then Baba dropped the body and that never occurred.
So what 18,000 inhabited worlds means, how do you say it's human only?
Because in that, in the page, there's a page on all of this, and it's very explicit. This, you wouldn't know from this, but on that page, it's a full type page. I guess Rano typed out a little bit of it. Most of it is in Francis's own handwriting. So,
is that to be found anywhere, that page?
This particular page?
Well, the notes on it.
They're somebody in the archives them? Here, so at some point it needs to get published. That would be a job, you know, how to do it properly. Yeah. No, it's very significant material. So here we have a whole new, you know, piece of work with God Speaks that nobody knew about. Isn't that amazing?
How big is it physically? How many pages?
Maybe 150 pages or something like that. All these little notes. But some of the pages will have a lot of stuff and some very little. Okay, here's another example. Maybe we can see this. No. It's something about the urge. Let me see. This is something about that.
Are all the notes in Francis's handwriting?
Yeah. No, it's not here. But there is something about, I better not try to reproduce it, I'll garble it. I can't quite remember it sharply enough. Is this the one? Oh yeah, okay. Whim has no rhyme nor reason. Urge has an element of reason and of longing. Impulse, half of whim and half of urge. Sudden tendency to act without reflection. Now, I'm not clear if this was actually something Baba said, or maybe Francis himself was looking it up in the dictionary or thinking it through preparatory to his editing work, I don't know. But you can see it's very relevant to God Speaks, because whim and urge are both words are used in God Speaks. As far as I can see, the word whim came up in Baba's usage for the first time in God Speaks. And it really comes up in chapter 8. Tian, have you encountered it before that in the earlier literature? It's generally speaking, as an English speaker, I feel a profound sense of inferiority when faced with Persian and Arabic and Sanskrit. They really have us beat. But whim is one proud contribution the English language has made. I have never seen such a good word in these other languages. And Scott McKay one time looked up the etymology of it, and the word whim just suddenly sprang into the English language without any known source. So we can be proud of the word. May have to hang our heads when I look at this vocabulary and this editing work. I think that our English words are pathetic compared to these other words. So there's some of the history of it. And I wanted to say a little bit about the style of God Speaks, since that topic.
I have a question.
Yeah.
So it goes a little bit back.
Yeah.
In Paul's letter to the editors for the second edition of God Speaks, Paul says, to use that particular discourse, existence is substance and love is shadow, to seal
yes.
the book.
Yeah.
But Ivy used a very lightweight supplement.
Yes.
The world of the astral, to seal it.
And she didn't put it at the end.
No, but she put it, she included it in the second.
I know.
The second last, but not the.
I know.
So do you know how it happened? And did you ever talk with Ira about it?
Okay. No. Yeah, I know. It's a little bit hard to find it. By the way, when you're dealing with God Speaks, you have probably the older second edition. It got reprinted in 1997, third printing it's called, and the Indian edition, which Yabod has six new copies of now, is a reproduction of that third printing. And to do that, they reflowed the text, and so all the page numbers are different. So actually, the standard edition is not just the second edition, it's the second edition, third printing. So if you see page numbers and it doesn't work for you, that's because you've got an earlier printing of it. So now let me see. I'd like to just read out a little bit of it. Because the style of God Speaks is one of the aspects of the book that sometimes people find challenging. It's a very hyper-redundant style, talking superficially. Each new sentence tends to carry a load of baggage from the sentence before, and carries it over. I'm not criticizing this, I'm just trying to characterize, like if Sir Francis Bacon, who is famed for his very precise economical style, were to do his edit, it would probably be a third as long. He would just really cut it down. And so one would ask, why did Baba write it this way? And I notice that Infinite Intelligence has probably had the same style. We have it just in a write-up by the Mandali, in my opinion. But it looks to me like it's the register of a dictation that probably was very similar to the dictation of God Speaks. And unfortunately, I don't have with me here in Australia Robert Russ's book, but The Water Carrier. But in it, there's a quotation from Francis talking about when Baba would explain things and how he would spend, I think, several days doing it. And it would take a long time for Baba to really express the significance he wanted to convey. I get that impression with God Speaks. It's like the avatar is trying to articulate out of a space that no one knows, a truth that in its real nature is unfathomable, and doesn't want to do it in a reductive way where it simply becomes simple ideas that you can understand. It has to carry some of the fathomless, oceanic feel with it. I'm just trying to describe my own sense of it, and I'm sure a lot of you could say your own things about it. So I would not want the style reduced at all. It would devastate it. And this hyper-redundancy of, this repetition has conveys something. And one expression I would use to say that is the ocean voice. I really hear the ocean voice, that that thunderous om sound, everywhere in it. And a lot of it has to do with the style. Yeah. That's very, very helpful. So who was saying earlier, Jim maybe, about how if you've been just reading it, well, that's part of what I would say in response to that. That ocean voice, even if you don't understand one word, you're going to get some of that in it. And there's this ponderous, constant going back to beginnings in God Speaks. It's even apparent in a lot of the presentation of the subject matter. For example, in the beginning of the fourth chapter on reincarnation, lo and behold, Baba goes back to the evolution of consciousness, the whim in the evolution of consciousness again. There's always a recapitulation in the coming forward. That's part of the style. John, have you noticed that in it? Or? Yeah. It's characteristic of God Speaks especially. Now, some of a critic of Baba's might say, well, that's because Baba was just disorganized and didn't know how to write in any other way. And I would retort to such a person, how do you account then for the universal message? Crisp, succinct, short sentences, punchy. How do you account for the discourses? Beautiful, classical, standard essays. Obviously, Baba was not bound to just that one style. But it does seem that he used it when he wanted to explain these kinds of topics of ultimate significance. That's what I think, anyway. And it's really worth it to immerse yourself. You sort of have to, it's like the ocean, you have to jump in, you know. Immerse yourself in it. Let it saturate through your skin and bones and blood so that it's part of the living pulse of your own breath. Yeah.
You know, you stay with God. Baba dictated a discourse for Francis to use for the book God Speaking. Mm. And Baba said, when you close your mouth, you utter that oceanic. That's right. The seventh shadow of the Son of God.
Yes.
So we will read God Speaks, the book, and have that experience of the oceanic. Do you feel there's some
difference? Very much. That particular, you know that discourse, it's a message of Baba's right before the third book of Stay with God, which is called God Speaking. Before that, there's a page and a half message. I presume Baba dictated that to Francis. Does anybody happen to know? Because I've never seen it anywhere else. So I presume Baba dictated it to Francis for incorporation into Stay with God. And actually, Francis did a magnificent job in that particular third book of Stay with God of capturing that oceanic feeling, that ocean voice of Baba's. He really, in his retelling of the Divine Theme Narrative, which he retells four times plus a coda in the Stay with God. But here's a, let me read a little bit, sort of from the most, when people talk about the style of God Speaks humorously about the most and all that kind of thing. This is the sort of passage they're talking about. I'll just read a little bit. Thus the soul, now without any medium or form, is conscious of the most finite impressions, sanskaras. But as long as consciousness is centered in impressions, the soul must necessarily experience those impressions. Therefore, in order to experience the impressions of the most first species of stone form dropped. You see, when I'm talking about hyper-redundancy, I mean this. It keeps recapitulating what he said in the sentence before. The consciousness of the soul, centered in the impressions of the dropped stone form, begins to associate with the most next species of stone form. So Sir Francis Bacon might say, Baba, why do you need to say most next? Why can't you just say next? Extra words. The soul identifies itself with this species of form, and the consciousness of the soul begins to experience, through association with the new medium of the most next species of stone form, the impressions of the most first species of the stone form. Have you ever read prose like this anywhere else? I haven't, with this particular language. The most important point to be understood here is that when the consciousness of the soul dissociates its identification from one form or medium and retains only the impressions of the form so dissociated, those impressions are experienced through another appropriate medium when the consciousness of the soul associates with the next medium or form. But this next medium or form is always created and molded of the consolidated impressions of the last species of form, which the soul associated and identified itself in which impressions were retained by the consciousness of the soul, even when dissociated from the form. That's a mouthful, huh? Look at how long that sentence is. It's an entire paragraph. No, half. Two sentences with these long, long sentences. That seems to have been the breath of Baba's, the language breath in which he conveyed this. Okay, I was going to read another passage, but there are other passages which will show the same thing with very different sequences of ideas, this long rhythm, this constant reversion to what was said before and bringing it back into the present matter that Baba wants to discuss. So the style is very much like that. So a lot of people, I think, reading this, just read this and feel, oh, I just can't understand it. But I think you probably actually do understand a lot of what Bob is saying. There's just it's like he wants his readers to marinate in it, in this sauce, you know, to not just say, oh, I understand that with the intellect and then sort of think you've understood it. No, you really need to assimilate in a much deeper way the significance. So there's a little bit on the style. Anybody else want to say anything about the style of the speech?
Well, when it's got the master next to that, to me, it just seems that if it took the master away, it would be missing something. It's just like the feel of it.
Yeah.
It feels like the master has to be there.
Yeah.
You know, that's just how you feel about it.
I really feel that too, and I have a hard time explaining why.
Yeah,
but the most first, once you get used to it, you can't live without it. Yeah, right.
Where you first started there, like the third and fourth paragraph, and also on that page, starts off with therefore and hence.
Yeah.
Is that Baba's style, or was that more how the Mundali would have, you know, written it down afterwards? Do you think therefore and hence were kind of Baba's words?
Well, it's sort of anybody's guess, but what I'm imagining is Baba is there dictating to Erich. And Erich, you know, you can't do better than Erich for a deep guy, right? And I would imagine he would put those words in to try to convey the sense of what Baba was expressing. It wasn't just words, it would be his look, facial gestures, and so how do you put that in words? My guess is Erich would use those words, but what he was really trying to express was something that Baba was communicating. Yeah.
Isn't it, I vaguely remember there was something where Baba would be very particular about specific words, and he would correct if he didn't
right.
like the word that Erich had come up with, he would correct it.
We see that in the film, the Ludwig van Gestern movie where Baba does. It does seem that Baba, on certain points, Baba would be very particular. And a lot of things Baba would just let go if it wasn't essential, as far as I can see. Trish, did you want to say something?
To me, it's kind of like a massage. It's like he's massaging it into you, even though you might not be grasping everything.
Yeah,
that's like a
caress,
reading it over and over again.
It's really worth it to let this language wash over you.
This style, I'm not sure about Gujarati. In Sanskrit, that most next and most first can be said in Sanskrit.
Oh, that's interesting.
So that could be just a true translation of Sanskrit, Adhyantam. So for example, so that is the initial next is Adhyantam, or initial last.
I can say
that word in Sanskrit, but Gujarati I don't know.
That's worth pursuing. Nothing interesting to
second
know.
Point I found of the repetition, when I started reading God's speech, it's so boring because it's so long sentence to assimilate in English. But if you read in Telugu, you have a long paragraphs of sentence to convey the message.
Uh-huh.
But repetition helped me to understand, go back to the first part of the stone's first impression,
Yeah.
It's so difficult to remember when you're moving forward.
Yeah.
Because now you're coming to fourth plane, but you're forgetting the first plane.
Yes.
And the first 30 pages is inculcated so repetitively to understand the concept, so it will not go away from your brain, even if you are in the end chapter. That's what I felt, that I can remember. So sometimes I went back to the first 30 pages and looked at, is it the same thing said again and again? So that means even after reading 3-4 times, you're actually, you can easily forget the concept.
Yes,
that's my feeling, it's nothing.
And a lot of the repetition in God Speaks also needs to be aware that sometimes Baba is actually bringing important new perspectives into it. I know that that's an easy, you know, excuse to make, you might say, but it's actually quite true. I didn't quite get to the point earlier, but like when in ideas, when he comes back to the divine theme in the eighth chapter and he starts over, he is repeating on the level of ideas, not language, but the level of ideas. But he has a very different context for it. A very different set of governing themes, really different. And so one needs to be aware of that. The repetition is meaningful and purposeful.
And marination is the right word.
Yeah, it's, God Speaks really is a book for those so inclined to be read over and over and over again. It gets into you, you know? It gets into your bones or something. It really changes you. Yeah.
I mean, that's what happened with me when I started reading it. The first time seemed to be some kind of a pleasure plan of mine, and it got a bit of fear, and then I said, oh, no, I have to start all over again. It's almost like this intellect is being chiseled away, and there's some kind of remembering and intuitive guidance coming from way, way back. And then I read the 30 pages about 30 times.
Right.
I just felt like going back and wouldn't progress any further. And it's a different ball game.
God Speaks can sustain that. You can read it over and over and over again, and it continues to feed. Yeah, that's the thing. When people say that God Speaks is just intellectual, that really does not do it justice. It is working with the intellect, no doubt, but there's a lot more going on that's kind of hard to find words for. You know, it's an unfathomable thing. I would like to, since I was going to go, we're almost to the end of the session, I'd like to read another thing that illustrates this too. Here we go. Let's see. It's another, just another passage showing some of this stylistic stuff. And it's from book 8, which I have become very, very fond of. When I first read God Speaks, I really didn't understand it. Why Baba was going back to it. Let me see. Is this what I want? I think it is. These are the very... Okay, now this is a very, very deep part of God Speaks, as opposed to most of God Speaks, which is very superficial. It actually is a particularly deep part. It's talking about the past, the present, and the future in their relation to creation, preservation, and destruction. And I've never seen this, anything like this for Baba. Okay. He's talking about the question about how it is that you can have dreams, prophetic dreams, dreams of things that haven't happened yet. How could a man living in the present through his own impressions of the past ever come to grips with futurity, even in a dream state, and associate in advance with impressions of future incidents and objects? What is it that endows man with the faculty of prescience?
You know, I've read that, what you're going to read over and over one time, and I just couldn't understand it.
It's amazing.
I look forward to seeing you translate it, if you're going to do it.
It's one of these things in God Speaks that sometimes reading it, I sort of suddenly feel like I see it, and then the next instant it's gone. There's a lot of that in God Speaks. These very associations with future objects and incidents, though experienced inadvertently and unknowingly by man in the present, are automatically developed and are inevitably there by virtue of man's being the creator of the drama in his dream state. No sooner does man become the creator of the drama of his dream state. You see how much repetition that is? He repeats from the last sentence, the whole phrase. No sooner does man do this dream state through the projection of his dormant impressions, than this very projection of his own dormant impressions reflects his past as if it were really his present. And man, finding himself involved in this drama, gets absorbed in his past while still maintaining his past to be his present. Now, this is the kind of famous sentence in God Speaks that make people like that. But he's saying something very profound. It's like in this, let's say, the very immediate present of this very room, what we're actually experiencing is our past in the form of impressions that is coming up and presenting itself as the present when it's actually the past, right? Everything is created by samskaras. So all that we experience is actually the past. That's not, that actually is an intelligible idea. But what a deep idea is. And Baba is saying the past is Brahma, the creator, the present is Vishnu, the preserver. And when we preserve things in the present, which we do by experiencing them, we're actually preserving them, the only reason we would preserve them is because we anticipate their destruction. Thus, we make inevitable the destruction of the present, which is the future. You see, that's what Baba's, I don't know, does that make sense? That's what Baba is trying to explain. And you see, the style is actually very well suited to that. And in fact, what we saw before, where he would, you know, take a sentence and bring a lot of the content from the previous sentence into the present sentence, you see, it's actually the same theme, right? It's actually bringing the past and representing it as the present. The present is actually the past, represented as the present. And he has to say this over, I don't know if I'm, this is my own utterly garbled, bastardized version of what Baba is saying, but he really is making a very deep, profound point, very relevant to what our present experience is. And this style is necessary, I feel, to make you really get it. That's what I think. So the style is not irrelevant. I'm very glad that Charles Purdom didn't re-edit it. I love the man, I admire the man, but he would have chopped it way, way, way down and cut out a lot of these features that I think the expression of God Speaks needs. Yeah.
Even what you say about the three passes of the same thing, it's mm-hmm. not with a child. Yeah, child will ask for an explanation. You'll give it one explanation, it doesn't get it. You'll try coming from another angle, still doesn't get it. You have another go from another angle. So it's almost like there's that too, I think, that he's
that's right.
trying. So if you can't see it that way, maybe you can see it this way.
So he's actually doing stylistically what he does with content also. And I'll just say this as the very last thing about the three passes, because we'll be going into that now more. What he does with the three passes, those are the three passes through the divine theme, right? I'll start this afternoon with the divine theme. And the divine theme is the journey of the soul that begins with the whim of God that precipitates the evolution of consciousness, which culminates in reincarnation in human form. Then there's the reverse turn through the involution of consciousness that culminates in the realization of God. That's the divine theme. Okay. Chapters 2 to 7 present it, I'm oversimplifying, but they present it in its basics, at least chapters 2 to 5 do, where he explains what evolution is with this you know, I read a little passage from it, the accumulation of sanskaras and then a new form and then the discarding of a form and a new form, all of that. And then in human form, the reincarnation process, and then in involution, the passage to the plains. The basic story he tells. Chapters 6 and 7 are a little more than that, but I'll skip it for the present. But this is an analogy I would use to try to give a sort of an idea of it. It's like Baba's telling the story of you, of me, of the Jivatma. That's us he's talking about. Stone form, metal form. We've done it all. We went through all of that. That's our life story. And in the first pass, he's like giving a basic story on a scale intelligible to the one doing it. Like, it's talking about a fish. Well, a fish wouldn't be thinking about sanskaras as such. But his discussion of that form it's almost like if you're doing a film. Do you mind being a fish, Kendra, for the moment? So there's Kendra the fish, and we're looking at her from this angle, and now suddenly she's eating another little fish, and we're sort of looking at that little fish, or, you know, all these other experiences. In other words, it's on a scale and a perspective where the one concerned you can really see well. It's on that kind of scale. In chapter 8, he goes back to the divine theme a second time, and it makes me think of like a Chinese landscape painting. You know, you've seen one where there's this vast landscape, and there's this little teensy-weensy dot that's a person. And somehow they've done it so that you immediately see that. You're seeing the journey of the soul in the context of these enormous cosmic principles. God as knowledge, power, and bliss, that turns out to be really important. God as creator, preserver, and destroyer. We just see how that's relevant to time. Time is produced by that. Wakefulness, dream, sound, sleep, primordial states of consciousness. The everything and the nothing. Fana, vaka, those Sufi terms come up. The spiritual hierarchy, who the avatar is. These huge themes are being brought into relation to the journey of the soul. He didn't say anything about that the first time through. And the third time through is in The Ten States of God, written by Erich. When, you know, Erich didn't even know that he remembered that he wrote it until Gary Kleiner told him, and Erich said, "What's this?" And Gary showed him the book where it says, "By Erich, just lie." Erich didn't even remember. And Erich said, "Mine was the hand that wrote." You know, he felt it was completely Baba's. That's certainly I do too. But in it, he goes through this divine theme a third time. But look at what he's done now. They're the states of God. Before that, we have a story. We have a narrative, right? A storyline, like a movie. Now, they have been transformed into eternal states because God is beyond time. They're states of God that are always there. We are seeing it from God's own eyes, you might say, out of time and beyond time. It's kind of an amazing transformation that he's done. That's how I see it anyway. So those three passes are really different from each other, and Baba is magnificently developing the subject. So with that, hold things too long. So we resume at 2:30 here.
Thanks, Lord. Thanks.